Has chordate features, like a tail with a stiff rod called a notochord, and a nerve cord like our spinal cord. Aside from that little bit of trivia, tunicates come in a really wide variety of both colors and shapes. Some of them are isolated individuals, while others are colonial, and many of them actually have a free swimming stage as well, where basically they look like a tadpole. They're called tunicates because of their tunic-like shape.
Lost in the still have that expression in the same sort of pattern.
Studying the DNA of ancient organisms is a window into our distant past. And if you look hard enough, you can find some creatures today that haven't changed much in hundreds of millions of years. This coast is home to a relative that shows us how ancient the genetic recipe is for building our brain.
Yeah, how do you know where to look?
Well, except you want to go deep into this.
Meet Peter Holland, head of zoology at Oxford University in England.
Right, okay. Well, we could start trying around
X
here.
X marks the spot?
X marks the spot. Let's give it a go. Right.
Okay, so what do I do?
Just shake it. You got one. There's an amphioxus.
We got any? Whoa, look at that little guy go. Hey!
Just dip it in the water again, you'll see it. It'll flick around.
Well, they really flick.
I see. There he is.
Hey, that's beautiful. Look at that. Which is the front?
It doesn't look like much, but this tiny creature, called amphioxus, has much to tell us about our own brains.
That is cool. Okay, that ranks as cool.
Okay, so let's take a look at a couple of these. So I brought this from the anatomy lab in Chicago. This is a human brain. And when I look at this, I don't find any obvious similarities to that.
Deep in the genes of this animal and the development of this animal, and deep in the genes of us and the development of us, there are the similarities.
So if you just take a look at that.
He's just moved.
Oh, he twisted away.
Yeah,
they're pretty active.
Holy cow. Oh, that is beautiful. God, they're so clear too. You can see right through them. You know, yeah, it's amazing. Yeah.
Amphioxus lives in the sand of the ocean floor, filtering algae out of the water. They have a simple nerve cord that runs the length of the body, which ends with a tiny swelling invisible to the naked eye.
If you look at the front end of this animal, you don't see it all expanded into a large skull or brain region. It's just pointed.
We might not have similar brains, but what we do have are similar genes. To make the forebrain, midbrain, and hindbrain, you need a series of control genes to tell the cells within the developing brain where they are. They map out the brain's three basic regions. Versions of the same master genes that help form our own brains are also active in amphioxus. But here, they're simply building the primitive nerve cord and the tiny swelling at its front. This means that the genetic roots of our own brains can be seen in creatures that first arose over 500 million years ago.
I think it gives us a glimpse into where our brains came from, into the basic organization of the brain of our ancestors.
I mean, I find that mind-blowing.
He's jumped off, guys.
Sorry.
He's going
we have an escapee, sorry.
He's on land living. He's gone rogue.
Yeah, he's gone for the next transition.
Exactly, he's in the Devonian now.
Just like civilization and the pilot. Sometimes they're not scavenging. They cannot. How do you see it tying itself in a knot? Look there. That's how it gets the slime off its body, and it slides the knot down its body. That's how it can get out of that. Sticky and thick this slime is. The guy's getting agitated. I heard this story recently that I was in the newspaper that there was, I don't know if it was a car accident or overturned, but there was a truck full of what they called slime eels, which is actually wrong because eels are rayfin fish. Story. also starting to see some serious armor going on, but even without jaws. And so you're wondering where those jawbones come from. The idea is that the gill, or the skeletal rod supporting the gills, evolved over time into the jaw-like structure. So does is it increases the surface area for food processing without increasing mothers internally form an egg and then lay the egg and then it hatches outside the mother's body. So that would be like also like birds, most reptiles. Now the thing is, we think of reptiles as being oviparous, which they are in large part, but in almost every category, there are always variations on the quote normal. So there are some snakes that give live birth, and so you can't. None of these are a specific synapomorphy, I should say, that's special for any given group. Okay, ovi means egg. Okay, so ovo, oviparous. Perhaps we should go to viviparous first, actually. They would only have one opening called the On the other hand, don't have swim bladders, but they interesting to think about gas exchange in water versus in air. So we have the air. Water is actually much less oxygen rich than air is. And so there's mechanisms that have evolved that allow more efficient gas exchange using gill structures in the water. And different adaptations also exist depending on what water the fish lives in. So if that fish lives in warm water, there's less oxygen content. If the fish lives in salt water, there's less oxygen content. And the fish lives in still water, there's less oxygen content. And so those are all kind of selective pressures that led to different adaptations. Now the question that I want you to keep in mind is, why is this gas exchange happening? And that's because of a cellular respiration. Cells need oxygen is because the mitochondria need that at the end of their electron transport chain to take oxygen, to take the electrons away, so that the ATP synthase can continue making ATP because of the electron transport chain still working. So the CO2 is a byproduct of the breakdown of food in animals, and well, in all organisms, well, in all eukaryotes. Actually not it's not about tetrapods.